Hello, this week we will look at the choice model involving more than two alternatives, and we will focus on the logit model. We saw the logit model in the context of the binary choice. We will now see how it generalizes to more than two alternatives. The starting point is again the utility specification. And in the context of this week, we will look at the three principal ingredients involved in this utility model. The first ingredient is the choice set that we denote by Cn. The second ingredient is the epsilon In, the error term. And the third is the Vin, the deterministic part of the utility function. Well, the idea is that in this week we will spend most of the time on the Vin, how to specify the deterministic part. This is where the modeling is the most involved. But let's first look at the choice set, okay, the Cn. This will be the topic of this video. The choice set is the list of alternatives. And what we need to do is to distinguish between two types of choice sets. The first type of choice set, I call it the universal choice set. This universal choice set is actually the point of view of the analyst. It contains all the potential alternatives that should be considered by the entire population. Well, it's actually restricted to the alternatives that are relevant for the analyst. Let's take an example where I'm interested to model the choice of transportation mode for commuters in a city. As an analyst, I'm interested in all possible transportation modes that are available in that city. So people can drive alone to work, people can share a ride, they can take a taxi, they can use the motorcycle, bicycle, they can walk, they can use the transit or the rail rapid transit. This is, in this example, my universal choice set. But I need also to take into account the point of view of the individual, of the traveler. And because not everybody has access to all these transportation modes which are available in the city. So the second choice set, the second concept of choice set, is called the individual's choice set. And it takes into account the fact that, for example, a traveler may have no driver license. Therefore, driving alone is not an option. Or there may be no car available in the household. Again, driving alone will not be an option either. Maybe people are not aware of transit services. They just moved in the city. They don't know that there are some buses available in their neighborhood. Or these transit services are not reachable, they are too far away. Then transit bus will be out. And the last example is that if the distance to walk is too long, people will not walk. They will not consider it as an option. So for this specific individual who has no driver license or who is not aware of transit services and who does not want to walk long distances, the choice set is reduced to sharing a ride, taxi, motorcycle, bicycle, and rail rapid transit. So we need to distinguish between the universal choice set and the individual choice set. Actually, identifying the choice set for each individual is a very difficult process. How do you model awareness? How do you know that people are aware of the existence of a bus service or not? How do you decide what does long distance mean? So would people walk 2 kilometers, 5 kilometers, 10? How do you know? How do you define this for each individual? And when you say that a bus stop is not reachable, what does it mean exactly? So these questions are very difficult to deal with. In the context of our models, because we want to derive operational models, we will assume that you can actually identify the choice set for each individual using deterministic rules. For example, first rule is that the car is available if individual N has a driver license and a car that is available in the household. And this information should be available as a data in the data file. Another rule could be walking is available if the trip length is shorter than 4 kilometers. Okay, again, maybe this 4 kilometers is an arbitrary decision, but that's what we decide here. These rules are deterministic. The way to represent the availability condition is by using an indicator. So for each individual N and each alternative I in the choice set, we will denote by delta IN the indicators that tells us if the alternative belongs to the choice set. So formally, delta IN would be 1 if alternative I is in the choice set of individual N, and 0 otherwise. So then we can write the choice model using delta IN as a variable, actually. So instead of writing the choice model P of I given Cn, so the choice of choosing alternative I given the choice at Cn of individual n, we can actually write the same model, but now conditional to the universal choice at C and the set of variables delta. And one way to do it is to say that using utility theory, the probability to choose alternative I is equal to the probability that UIn plus the log of delta IN is the largest among all alternatives in the choice set. If delta IN is equal to 1, log of delta IN will be 0, and we are back to the original utility. If delta IN happens to be 0, the log of 0 is actually minus infinity, and therefore it cannot be the largest possible. So this way of coding the model, of presenting it, allows us to write the model either as a function of the universal choice set or as a function of the individual choice set. And depending on the context, we will use one or the other representation. So now that we have looked at the choice set, that we have made these assumptions about universal choice sets, individual specific choice sets, the fact that we use deterministic rules, and the fact that we can write the model either using one or the other choice set, now we will move to the next video, where we will talk about the error term, the epsilon IN, and the assumptions that we will have to do for the epsilon IN.